Okay. So I guess I'll join you there.
Please come in. Maybe I should do the PowerPoint on the floor. Is it all right? Okay.
I'm Ray. Your name again? Nellie.
Tristan.
Melissa.
Martin.
Are you both NIU?
Yeah.
Okay. Grad.
Freshman.
Okay. And you know each other?
Yeah.
The three of you?
No.
Just you two?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll just play this right now. Sorry. Thanks for your patience. Did you all get a handout each, or a couple of handouts? If you're interested, if you're not, that's perfectly fine. So are you required to write something about this?
No.
When you're done? Oh, okay, good. Okay. So, for the third time, for the second. So this session is about Freire, Father Freire. Again, where is he from, Freire? Brazil. Okay, do you speak Portuguese?
No.
So we only have one person who studied Portuguese here. And if you have something you really want to say, just say it. Or let me know. So introduction. This is Freire. He's been all over the world. He was born and raised in Brazil, but there was a dictatorship, like many countries in the world. And he was in prison, and he had to leave the country. He went to Switzerland, and he worked there. He worked with the World Council of Churches in Geneva, Switzerland. And there he was able to reflect and to write about his ideas. And his ideas are very important even today. Were you there this morning? No? Okay. So this morning they talked about the Freire way of teaching and thinking and why we should use the Paulo Freire approach. And we will see what it is. And the problem with studying Freire is that many people just quote Freire like he said something once and for all, but he did not. In fact, he had changed his mind, his ideas, several times. And he did not speak with one voice in the sense that as we age, we change our ideas. That's what he did too. Like, you know, when you're young, when you're middle-aged, and you're older, you have certain ideas. Like, if you're young, you want to rebel, right? And anything your parents say is wrong. And then when you're middle-aged, you have your own kids who say, kids should listen to you. Then when you're much older, you say, maybe I want to just have fun before I die, right? And he went through that kind of changes as well himself. And he spoke with three voices. And I'm saying, so what are these three different voices that we hear? So there are three major books that he wrote. He wrote a lot of books. Critical Consciousness, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, of Hope, Freedom, and so on. I'm looking at the three major works. The Young Freire would be Education for Critical Consciousness, referring to 202. And then the second one, Oppressed, that's the most famous book that he's written. And the third one, it's Of Hope. This is what Molly Sweet did. Does anyone know Molly Sweet? No. She's one of the organizers of this conference. She mentioned this book as the inspiration of the conference. Okay, so Paulo Freire, there he is. So the first face, oh, there are three faces, and you see your hand also has that meaning up and down. He had cited many others. And if you see, they are mostly Christian. Okay? You have Christian thinker, a Catholic thinker, Jean Marie Gabriel Marcel. And then you have a sociologist, and then you have a sociologist, and many of them are existentialists. It simply means it's a way of thinking of the world that we are born to this world, like it or not. Okay? And we bear responsibility for happiness and sadness. If we say, well, I'm brown and I'm fat, I'm doomed to be a failure. That's my problem, because I said, I'm brown and I'm fat, I'm doomed to fail. That's the decision I make. That's what existentialism means. But I can also take it the other way and say, well, I know I'm born brown, and I just have to accept it, and I have to be proud of it. And then I'm fat, well, either I accept it, like Oprah, after she tried a million diets, it didn't work. She said, okay, fine, this is who I am. Or I'll work and hope that I'll be slim. That's what existentialism means. Like, it's my responsibility. I'm doomed to be happy or sad the way I want my life to be. If I say I'm a hopeless case, there you go, I just said it, I'm a hopeless case. But if I say no, I'm gonna change my life around. I'll be happy that I'm brown, and I'll be proud of it. And tell everyone I'm brown, and well, so what, I'm fat, but I'm working on it, okay? So this is how he was thinking when he was younger. So he was a Christian saying, well, some people say if you are Christian, we have the original sin, no? You can think of it as a negative, like, too bad, you're doomed to fail. Or you could say, well, I can work it out. I can live another one life if I want to, and work it out. And I'm not doomed to burn hell for people who are Christian. I can work for my salvation. So earlier on, he was a Christian existentialist. So the kind of action would be, would include like, I would pray. If I have a problem, I'll pray. Maybe it will work. But I would take up the responsibility to make sure I can change things, not just to accept things as they are. Okay? You see the difference between saying it's a hopeless case and I can change it. Okay? And then he had also cited a few others who are actively involved in society. You don't just say, well, I'm undocumented, or I don't have a job, or I haven't finished high school, and that's the end of it. Rather, I'm saying, well, if I'm undocumented, maybe I can have a Twitter account and let everyone know we can organize, and we're undocumented, we can do something about it. Instead of being quiet and being afraid, let's be political and active. Okay, so this is what means when you're committed, you're doing something about it. Okay, so maybe a Twitter account or Facebook or Instagram, whatever, it would work. Anyway, that's, you know, the generation nowadays, right? Teachers have to accept that, like it or not, that the young ones are using social media. Okay, so he was saying you have to work around that. And, okay. And the focus was changing our mindset. We could say that, he said, there are many ways by which you can think. What is, we're just animals. What do we have in common with animals? Think of what do we have in common with animals? What do animals do that we do? Yeah, that's one. We eat, or else we die. We're just like animals. Sleep. I don't know if fish sleep, maybe they do. Okay, yeah, I think they do. They're disturbed easily. Okay, what else?